Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to the Church of St. Patrick. Today we celebrate Palm Sunday of the Passion of our Lord. The second collection today is to help with the maintenance bills of our parish buildings. Kindly make sure all cell phones are turned off before we begin our liturgy. Our parish children's mobile Easter celebration will be held next Saturday, April 3rd, in the parish parking lot. Call the rectory office by tomorrow, March 29th, to register. Please place your donation to help make the celebration for our kids a success in the weekly collection, or place it in the mailbox at the 4th Street Rectory door. Just in time for Cinco de Mayo, our parish is sponsoring a sale of handcrafted salsa from Casa de George in Bethlehem. Special gift delivery is available. The order form and flavors are in the bulletin. The deadline to order is tomorrow, March 29th. Estimates say that human beings make as many as 35,000 choices each day. Through his sin of pride, the first man, Adam, attempted equality with God. Through humility and docility, Jesus put aside pride and accepted death on a cross for the salvation of mankind. In each moment, we have a choice. Will we follow the example of Adam or the example of Jesus? We remember at this Mass William and Anne Marie Ferran. Our presider is Monsignor O'Connor, assisted by Deacon Jack Quirk. Please stand.
Since the beginning of Lent until now, we have prepared our hearts by penance and charitable works. Today we gather together to herald the whole Church the beginning of the celebration of our Lord's Paschal Mystery, that is to say, of his Passion and Resurrection. For it was to accompany this mystery that he entered his own city of Jerusalem. Therefore, with all faith and devotion, Let us commemorate the Lord's entry into the city for our salvation, following in his footsteps, so that we may, by his grace, partakers of the cross, we may have a share also in his resurrection and in his life. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ the King in exaltation may reach the eternal Jerusalem through him who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. When Jesus and his disciples drew near to Jerusalem in Bethany at the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately on entering it, you will find a colt tethered on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone should say to you, 'Why are you doing this?' reply, 'The master has need of it and will send it back here at once.' So they went off and found a colt tethered at the gate outside on the street, and they untied it. Some of the bystanders said to them, 'What are you doing untying the colt?' They answered them, 'Just as Jesus had told them to.' And they permitted them. So they brought the colt to Jesus and put their cloaks over it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut from the fields. Those preceding him, as well as those following, kept crying out, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that is to come. Hosanna in the highest.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ Jesus Christ.
Graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering, and so merit a share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Lord God has given me a well-trained tongue, that I might know how to speak to the weary a word that will rouse them. Morning after morning, he opens lose my ear that I may hear, and I have not rebelled, have not turned back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who plucked my beard. My face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help, therefore I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
From the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness, and found human in appearance. He humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him, and bestowed upon him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Jesus Christ according to Mark. The Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread were to take place in 2 days' time. So the chief priests and the scribes were seeking a way to arrest him by treachery and put him to death. They said, "When he was in Bethany, reclining at table in the house of Simon the leper, a woman came with an alabaster jar of perfumed oil, costly, genuine spikenard. She broke the alabaster jar and poured it on his head. There were some who were indignant.
Why has there been this waste of perfume? It could have been sold for more than 300 days' wages, and the money
they were infuriated with her. Jesus said,
"Let her alone. Why do you make trouble for her? She has done a good thing for me. The poor you will always have with you, and whatever you wish you can do good to them, but you will not always have me. Since she has done what she could, she has anticipated anointing my body for burial. Amen, I say to you, wherever the gospel is proclaimed to the whole world, what she has done will be told in memory of her."
Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went off to the chief priests to hand him over to them. When they heard him, they were pleased and promised to pay him money. Then he looked for an opportunity to hand him over. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, when they sacrificed the Passover lamb, his disciples said to him,
"Where do you want us to go and prepare for you to eat the Passover?"
He sent two of his disciples and said to them,
"Go into the city, and a man will meet you, carrying a jar of water. Follow him. Wherever he enters, say to the master of the house, 'The teacher says, where is my guest room, where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' Then he will show you a large upper room furnished and ready. Make the preparations for us there."
The disciples then went off, entered the city, and found it just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. When it was evening, he came with the 12, and as they reclined at table and were eating, Jesus said,
"Amen, I say to you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me."
They began to be distressed and said to him one by one,
"Surely it is not I."
He said to them,
"One of the 12, one who dips with me into the dish, for the Son of Man indeed goes as it is written of him. But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would be better for that man if he had never been born."
While they were eating, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them, and said,
"Take it, this is my body."
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, and they all drank from it. He said to them,
"This is my blood of the covenant, which will be shed for many. Amen, I say to you, I shall not drink again the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God."
Then, after singing a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
"All of you will have your faith shaken. For it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be dispersed.' But after I have been raised up, I shall go before you to Galilee."
Peter said to him,
"Even though all should have their faith shaken, mine will not be."
Then Jesus said to him,
"Amen, I say to you, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me 3 times.
But he vehemently replied,
"Even though I should have to die with you, I will not deny you."
They all spoke similarly. Then they came to a place called Gethsemane, And he said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I pray."
He took with him Peter, James, and John, and began to be troubled and distressed. Then he said to them,
"My soul is sorrowful even to death. Remain here and keep watch."
He advanced a little and fell to the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass by him. He said,
"Abba, Father, all things are possible to you. Take this cup away from me, but not what I will, but what you will."
Then he returned. When he returned, he found them asleep. He said to Peter,
"Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not undergo the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak."
Withdrawing again, he prayed, saying the same thing. Then he returned once more and found them asleep, for they could not keep their eyes open and did not know what to answer him. He returned a third time and said to them,
"Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? It is enough. The hour has come. Behold, the Son of Man is to be handed over to sinners. Get up, let us go. See, my betrayer is at hand."
Then, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, accompanied by a crowd with swords and clubs, who had come from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. His betrayer had arranged a signal with them, saying,
"The man I shall kiss is the one. Arrest him and lead him away securely."
He came and immediately went over to him and said,
"Rabbi."
And he kissed him. At this, they laid hands on him and arrested him. One of the bystanders drew his sword, struck the high priest's servant, and cut off his ear. Jesus said to them in reply,
"Have you come out as against a robber, with swords and clubs, to seize me? Day after day I was with you teaching in the temple area, yet you did not arrest me, but that the scriptures may be fulfilled."
And then they all left him and fled. Now a young man followed him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth about his body. They seized him, but he left the cloth behind and ran off naked. They led Jesus away to the high priest, and all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes came together. Peter followed him at a distance into the high priest's courtyard, and was seated with the guards, warming himself at the fire. The chief priest and the entire Sanhedrin kept trying to obtain testimony against Jesus in order to put him to death, but they found none. Many gave false witness against him, but their testimony did not agree. Some took the stand and testified falsely against him, alleging,
"We heard him say, 'I will destroy this temple made with hands. Within 3 days, I will build another, not made with hands.'"
Even so, their testimony did not agree. The high priest rose before the assembly and questioned Jesus, saying,
"Have you no answer? What are these men testifying against you?"
But he was silent and answered nothing. Again the high priest asked him and said to him,
"Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?"
Then Jesus answered,
"I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven."
At that, the high priest tore his garments and said,
"What further need have we of witnesses? You have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?"
They all condemned him as deserving to die. Some began to spit on him. They blindfolded him and struck him and said to him,
"Prophesy."
And the guards greeted him with blows. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the high priest's maids came along. Seeing Peter warming himself, she looked intently at him and said,
"You too were with the Nazarene, Jesus."
But He denied it, saying,
I neither know nor understand what you are talking about.
So he went out into the outer court, and the cock crowed. The maid saw him and began again to say to the bystanders,
this man is one of them.
Once again, he denied it. A little later, the bystanders said to Peter once more,
surely you are one of them, for you too are Galilean.
He began to curse and to swear,
I do not know this man whom you are talking.
And immediately a cock crowed a second time. Then Peter remembered the word that Jesus had said to him, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times. He broke down and went. As soon as morning came, the chief priests with the elders and the scribes, that is, the whole Sanhedrin, held a council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate questioned him,
are you the king of the Jews?
He said to him in reply,
you say so.
The chief priests accused him of many things. Again, Pilate questioned him,
have you no answer? See how many things they accuse you of.
Jesus gave him no further answer, so that Pilate was amazed. Now on the occasion of the feast, he used to release to them one prisoner whom they requested. A man called Barabbas was then in prison, along with the rebels who had committed murder in a rebellion. The crowd came forward and began to ask him to do for them as he was accustomed. Pilate answered,
do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?
For he knew that it was out of envy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate again said to them in reply,
then what do you want me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?
They shouted again,
crucify him.
Pilate said to them,
why? What evil has he done?
They only shouted the louder,
crucify him.
So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas to them, and after he had Jesus scourged, handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers led him away inside the palace, that is, the praetorium, and assembled the whole cohort. They clothed him in purple, and waving a crown of thorns, placed it on him. They began to salute him with,
hail, King of the Jews!
And kept striking his head with the reed and spitting upon him. They knelt before him in homage. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the purple cloak, dressed him in his own clothes, and led him out to crucify him. They pressed into service a passerby, Simon, a Cyrenian, who was coming in from the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to carry his cross. They brought him to the place of Golgotha, which is translated place of the skull. They gave him wine drunk with mirth, but he did not take it. Then they crucified him and divided his garment by casting lots for them to see what each would take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, the King of the Jews. With him, they crucified two revolutionaries, one on his right and one on his left. Those passing by revealed him, shaking their heads and saying,
aha, you who destroyed the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself by coming down from the cross.
Likewise, the chief priests with the scribes mocked him among themselves and said,
he saved others, he cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down now from the cross, and he may see.
Those who were crucified with him also kept abusing him. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And at 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
Eloi, lima sabachthani,
which is translated,
my God, why have you forsaken me?
Some of the bystanders who heard it said,
look, he is calling me Elijah.
One of them ran, soaked a sponge with wine, put it on a reed, and gave it to him to drink, saying,
wait, Elijah comes to take him down.
Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. Sanctuary was torn in two from top to bottom. When the centurion who stood facing him saw how he breathed his last, he said,
truly this man was the Son of God.
There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of the younger James and of Jose, and Salome. These women followed him when he was in Galilee and ministered to him. There were also many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem. When it was already evening, since it was the day of preparation, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a distinguished member of the council, who was himself awaiting the kingdom of God, came and courageously went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate was amazed that he was already dead. He summoned the centurion and asked him if Jesus had already died. And when he learned of it from the centurion, he gave the body to Joseph. Having brought a linen cloth, he took him down, wrapped him in the linen cloth, and laid him in a tomb that had been hewn. Then he rolled a stone against the entrance to the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joses, watched where he was laid. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise. In the Old Testament scriptures, the Psalms, which the church prays daily in its office, those Psalms embody every human experience we can imagine. Today's responsorial psalm, my God, why have you abandoned me? Or, why have you forsaken me? Jesus prays that psalm from the cross. And while we hear those words, we may say, the people may say, oh, those in his time, he is losing his faith. He believes God has abandoned him. What Jesus was doing was praying that psalm, a psalm that every human being can identify with. You and I, at one point or other in our lives, embrace the cross. In some challenge, in some suffering, in some injustice, in some untrue claim about us. In one way or another, we experience that sense of abandonment. And what Jesus is showing us by praying that psalm is that no, God does not abandon us. Although that's the feeling we have. That's the emotion we experience. That's what it seems like. And certainly as we read the Passion narrative, this one today from St. Mark, the oldest gospel, and we know that the Passion narratives are
are the oldest parts of each of the gospel. We are reading the actual closest account and narrative to the event. We see the great suffering that Jesus undertook in his passion that we begin to commemorate during this Holy Week. And in doing so, Jesus embraces the human condition. God could have saved the world in any way that he chose. God is God. He can do anything in any way. But he chose to save the world through the incarnation of the Word made flesh and through the great human suffering of the passion, death, crucifixion of our Lord. To this day, crucifixion is perhaps the most harsh form of execution that the world has ever known. It was brutal. And so Jesus experienced the worst of human suffering. And he did it that way to show us something. He did it that way to remind us that although at times we feel abandoned by God, though at times we feel that our suffering is unbearable, God knows what we experience because he experienced it himself. Thus he prayed that psalm. So today, my brothers and sisters, as we begin this Holy Week, and as we meditate today on the Passion of Jesus, and as we will do all this Holy Week, the various commemorations and ceremonies of Holy Week, the central mystery of our faith, the core of our belief. This is what our faith is about. This is what our life is about, centered on the loving God who did not cause sin and suffering, but through suffering redeemed us from it and restored us to our relationship with the living God. May we reverently, prayerfully, meditatively, gratefully pray during this Holy Week for the love of God in our lives, which nothing can limit. The love of God in our lives from which nothing can separate us. The love of God which brings us the gift of eternal life.
I believe in one God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made. For us men, for our salvation, came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. He suffered death, and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. God the Father sent his Son Jesus to bring unity to the human race through his suffering and death. Let us now offer our prayers and petitions for the whole world.
That the Lord will bless the efforts of our Pope Francis and all leaders of the Church as they spread the gospel to all throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
That world leaders will reflect the sovereignty of Christ as they work to eliminate unnecessary suffering from their countries. Lord, in your mercy, that all Christians will embrace the joy of this Holy Week with a commitment to repent of past sins and strive for holiness. Lord, in your mercy, that government and public health officials will be granted wisdom and strength in their efforts to manage the COVID-19 pandemic as the administration of the vaccine to all increases. Lord, in your mercy, that all who are suffering physical, financial, or psychological hardships due to the coronavirus will have their burdens lifted by the Lord and be consoled by his healing hand. Lord, in your mercy, that the crucifixion of Christ for all people will teach us that there is no such thing as a worthless life or a person that God does not love. Lord, in your mercy, that those suffering from illness, both mental and physical, and all who have asked us to pray for them, will feel the compassion of Jesus the healer through the kindness of their caretakers. Lord, in your mercy, that all who have died, those who have died unremembered and unmourned, and Deborah Kurtick, Albert Pascuzio, and Isabel Bell Putz, they find everlasting joy in God, in our Father's kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
That Joan Kelly, whom we remember in this Mass, will always share in the eternal banquet. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And for those petitions that we hold deep in our hearts, Lord, in your mercy.
Father, you allowed your Son to suffer for the salvation of all throughout the world. As you answer our prayers, give us grace to follow the example of Jesus, for he is Lord forever and ever. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that, though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by this sacrifice made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners, and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so, with all the angels, we praise you, as a joyful celebration we to acclaim. This is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more, giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." bride for the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Alfred, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Thank you.
Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy.
Thank you. for spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in this most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually to my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself fully to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Let us pray. Nourished with these sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your Son, you have brought us to hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection, you may lead us to where you call, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Prayer to combat the corona pandemic. Most merciful and triune God, we come to you in our weakness, we come to you in our fear, we come to you in trust, for you alone are our hope. We place before you the disease present in our world. We turn to you in our time of need. Bring wisdom to doctors, bring understanding to scientists. Endow caregivers with compassion and generosity. Bring healing to those who are ill. Protect those who are most at risk. Give comfort to those who have lost a loved one. Welcome those who have died in your eternal home. Stabilize our communities. Unite us in our compassion. Remove all fear from our hearts. Fill us with confidence in your care. Jesus, I trust in you. Jesus, I trust in you. Jesus, I trust in you. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Look, we pray, O Lord, on this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ did not hesitate to be delivered into the hands of the wicked and submit to the agony of the cross, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Before the Mass is ended,
thanks be to God.
Say my God.
Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God and you, we humbly pray. And do thou, O